हेलो
हेलो।
गुड इवनिंग मैम,
गुड इवनिंग।
हाउ आर यू? ऑल
आई एम फाइन, थैंक यू।
सेट? सो
यस
शुड वी स्टार्ट?
यस यस।
ओके, जस्ट गिव मी 1 मिनट प्लीज।
जल्दी आशो।
गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी, वेलकम टू दिस इवनिंग एपिसोड ऑफ परस्यू, एंड दिस इज परस्यू 5C1, which is pathology of blood vessels and heart, and we are streaming live from Kolkata. A very interesting topic. It is a continuation of our previous topic on heart and the blood vessels. Today's topic is pathophysiology of cardiomyopathies and cardiac tumors, and to talk on that we have Dr. Colonel Tanushree Mukherjee. She is an MBBS from JMC Bhopal, MD Path from AFMC Pune, a DNB in pathology. She's also trained in Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai for 2 years. She's also a diplomat fellowship of Royal College of London, professor and senior advisor pathology and oncopathology at the Command Hospital, Eastern Command, Kolkata. She has more than 25 years of experience in professional service in Armed Force Medical College. She's a recognized postgraduate teacher in West Bengal University of Health Sciences, a DNB teacher, an affiliate member of RCPath London, a life member of ISC and IEPM with multiple national and international publications, best reviewer for MJFI 2019. She was also the HOD Command Hospital, Chandi Mandir, Western Command. Before I ask ma'am to start, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request ma'am, please share your screen and let's start. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Is the screen visible?
Yeah, please make it full screen, ma'am. Yeah, perfectly fine. Please start.
Okay. So today's topic, cardiomyopathies and cardiac tumors. And from postgraduate's point of view, important because in autopsy, it is very vital to know the various cardiomyopathies because it can be asked in the viva. And cardiac tumors also, the specific entities are very important. So first I will discuss the cardiomyopathy. It is the disease of the heart muscle in which the heart loses its ability to pump blood effectively. The heart becomes enlarged or abnormally thick or rigid. As I will discuss subsequently, the various types of cardiomyopathy and how the growth is different in different types of cardiomyopathy. And in rare cases, the muscle tissue in the heart is replaced with scar. And as the cardiomyopathy progresses, it can progress to heart failure, arrhythmias, systemic and pulmonary edema, and more rarely, endocarditis. So three main types of cardiomyopathies are dilated, hypertrophic, and restrictive cardiomyopathy. Here, as you can see, the three main types are hypertrophic, dilated, restrictive, but there are two more etiologies, arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy and unclassified. And the causes are familial, genetic, non-familial and non-genetic. And sometimes it can be idiopathic or it can be secondary to some other causes. So the main three which we see here, like the dilated, in which the left ventricular ejection fraction is less than 40%. In hypertrophic and restrictive, there is impairment of compliance, that is, it is a diastolic dysfunction. But the dilated cardiomyopathy, which is more common, it is a systolic dysfunction. The causes of dilated are too many, is listed here. And I have put material on the slide because I will be giving PDF to the students. So important points I will be discussing. So dilated, genetic, alcohol, then peripartum cardiomyopathy, myocarditis, hemochromatosis, anemia, doxorubicin, sarcoidosis, and secondary dysfunction due to ischemic heart disease, valvular heart disease, hypertensive heart disease, or congenital heart disease. Then hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, usually it is genetic. Friedreich ataxia, storage diseases, infants of diabetic mothers. And secondary due to hypertensive heart disease and aortic stenosis. Then restrictive cardiomyopathy causes amyloidosis, radiation-induced fibrosis, idiopathic. And secondary to pericardial constriction. So these are the main three things, and this tabulation is very nice. It is good to remember. So this is the pictorial depiction, normal, and the four-chamber dilatation in dilated cardiomyopathy and hypertrophic and restrictive cardiomyopathy. And this photomicrograph is given very well in Robin. So this is the flow chart which discusses the various causes. So easy to remember, dilated and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and the causes as I have listed already, and the clinical features which will be heart failure, sudden death, atrial fibrillation, stroke. So first I will discuss the dilated cardiomyopathy, most common form of cardiomyopathy, more common in men, generally occurs in adults aged 20 to 60 years. There is a left ventricular thinning and the heart muscle dilates or stretch, and there is a ventricular chamber size increase. So this causes the various symptoms of heart failure, fatigue, edema and breathlessness. So the causes you can see here, it is listed: ischemic, idiopathic, hypertensive, infectious like HIV, viral myocarditis, alcoholic, most prevalent toxic cause is alcohol, then single gene mutations involve dystrophin, metavinculin, lamin, infections like coccidia, HIV, bacterial, fungal, then nutritional deficiencies, cardiotoxins, purpurium, then metals, autoimmune and systemic disorders, pheochromocytoma, radiotherapy, diabetes and thyroid disease. This can all cause dilated cardiomyopathy. Over 50 genes are known to be mutated in this form of cardiomyopathy. An autosomal dominant inheritance became the predominant pattern, mutations affecting cytoskeletal proteins, or proteins that link the sarcomere to the cytoskeleton. X-linked dilated cardiomyopathy is associated with mutations in dystrophin, a cell membrane protein that physically couples the intracellular cytoskeleton to the extracellular matrix, and the mutations of various mitochondrial proteins that Then infections can occasionally be detected in the myocardium from late stage dilated cardiomyopathy patients. So this is the molecular description. As we see here, the pattern of inheritance is variable, autosomal dominant, X-linked forms, and the infantile forms or Bart syndrome, which typically presents in male infants, characterized by neutropenia, 3-methyl glutaconic aciduria, growth retardation, and mitochondrial dysfunction. Mutations in the gene T4.5, which encodes the protein tepezin, causes Bart syndrome. So it is important to remember this, the molecular description, that it can be of three types: autosomal forms, then X-linked forms, and infantile forms. Then something about the peripartum cardiomyopathy. It occurs late in gestation or several weeks to months postpartum. Etiology is multifactorial, including pregnancy-associated hypertension, volume overload, nutritional deficiency. The primary defect is impaired angiogenesis within the myocardium, leading to ischemic injury. Half of these patients will spontaneously recover. Iron overload in the heart can result either from hereditary hemochromatosis or from multiple transfusions. And iron overload also can cause restrictive cardiomyopathy in this case. But dilated cardiomyopathy is the most common manifestation. So the, as I've told, is a shortness of breath, syncope, and angina in dilated cardiomyopathy. The various laboratory tests which can be done, as well as the echo, chest radiography, cardiac MRI, ECG, and the metabolic panel, thyroid function, cardiac biomarkers, and B-type natriuretic peptide assay. So grossly, when you see your heart, the heart assumes a globular shape. There's a pronounced ventricular chamber dilatation, diffuse endocardial thickening, and atrial enlargement, often with thrombi in the appendages. This is a cross description of dilated cardiomyopathy. Microscopic, increase in myocyte nucleocytes. Why? Because of the synthesis of DNA and they become polyploid. Myofibrillary loss within the myocyte. Focal myocyte death and necrosis. Increase in interstitial T lymphocytes and macrophages. Interstitial fibrosis. So this is the microscopic features which can be found in dilated cardiomyopathy. So the fibrosis is interstitial and begins to surround and isolate the individual myocyte, as it is seen in the photomicrograph. So this is diagnosed most commonly between 20 and 50 years of age, and as I have told, it is more common in male gender. And cardiac transplantation is the only definitive treatment. The second entity is the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. When the heart muscle thickens abnormally, this is a diastolic dysfunction. It could be an obstructive type. The septum thickens and bulges into the left ventricle, blocks the flow of blood into the aorta. So there is a loss of compliance. So symptoms include chest pain, dizziness, shortness of breath, or fainting. And non-obstructive type, the entire ventricle may become thicker, symmetric ventricular hypertrophy, or it may happen only at the bottom of the heart, which is called as the apical hypertrophy. The right ventricle also may be affected. So what happens? There is buildup of increased pressure in the ventricles and lungs, and there is a decreased compliance and changes in the cardiac muscle, which interfere with the heart's electrical signals, leading to arrhythmias and sudden cardiac arrest. So causes, as I have enumerated earlier, inherited because of a gene mutation. It develops over time because of high blood pressure or aging. Often the cause is unknown. which is the most common inherited cardiac disease. Dilated one was the most common cardiomyopathy, but hypertrophic is the most common inherited cardiac disease. Prevalence in children is unknown, but population-based studies report an annual incidence of 0.3 to 0.5 per 100,000. It is common in both genders. It's a heterogeneous genetic disease, may be familial or non-familial. Mutations is identified in numerous sarcomeric protein genes. Most common are the beta myosin heavy chain and myosin binding protein C. So there's a missense mutation in one of the several genes encoding proteins. This pathophysiology is important, and usual pattern of transmission is autosomal dominant. So all the mutations which occur here, they all affect the sarcomeric protein and increase myofilament function. This results in myocyte hypercontractility, increased energy use, and a net negative energy balance. So of the various sarcomeric proteins, beta myosin heavy chain is most frequently involved, followed by myosin binding protein C and troponin T. This I've told already. So clinical features, many individuals are asymptomatic and diagnosis may be incidental or identified during screening. And the laboratory tests include routine hematology, glucose, cardiac enzymes, renal, thyroid, liver function test, pH, electrolytes, and uric acid. Disease progression is difficult to predict. Genetic testing cannot identify high-risk patients due to differences in penetrance and expressivity. Grossly, it is explained by left ventricular wall thickness more than 15 millimeters, septal and posterior wall thickness ratio more than 1.3 in normotensive patients, or septal and posterior wall thickness ratio more than 1.5 in hypertensive patients. So this is important parameter which is seen in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. In children, hypertrophy is defined as wall thickness more than 2 standard deviations above the mean. So this ratio is important in cases of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Microscopy, cardiomyocytes are hypertrophic with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm and box-shaped nuclei. Myocytes display bizarre forms with Y-shaped branching, frequent side-to-side junctions, or a characteristic whorled appearance, usually around the central fibrous core. Interstitial fibrosis may be seen, which forms the arrhythmogenic foci. So this is the microscopic description for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And myocyte disarray is specific for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So as I have told earlier, the molecular description, genetic testing is used to identify family members, and differential diagnosis could be many, like many metabolic disorders, mitochondrial myopathies, mutations in desmin, neuromuscular disease like Friedreich's ataxia, muscular dystrophies, and drug use like anabolic steroids, endocrine disorders. Treatment is surgical or alcohol septal ablation. I will not go into detail of this. And heart transplantation for end stage. And one entity is the arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, also called as arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. The primary heart muscle disease characterized by progressive myocardial atrophy of the right ventricle with transmural fatty or fibrofatty replacement, either segmental or diffuse, accounting for electrical instability at risk of life-threatening ventricular arrhythmias. So almost 30% of cases of sudden deaths in athletes has been ascribed to this entity. Morphologically, the right ventricular wall is severely thinned owing to myocyte replacement by fatty infiltration and lesser amount of fibrosis. Site is the right ventricular free wall. It could be genetic or in an autosomal dominant pattern with variable expression. Most common symptom is palpitation. Palpitation can occur at rest, but it's often triggered by physical activity and it can cause lightheadedness or blackout. Diagnosis by ECG, echo, cardiac MRI, and right ventricular angiography. Grossly, this is the section of the heart. Heart weight is usually normal. The right side of the heart appears yellowish or whitish due to fatty or fibrofatty infiltration of the underlying myocardium. And this is the microscopic feature. Histology of the free wall of the right ventricle shows disappearance of the myocardium with transmural fibrofatty replacement. Differential diagnosis could be acquired heart disease, congenital heart disease, and we have to rule out the other miscellaneous causes like sarcoid. Treatment, again cardiac defibrillator and ablation therapy. Then the fourth entity is a restrictive cardiomyopathy, which tends to affect mostly older adults. The ventricles become stiff and rigid due to replacement of the normal heart muscle with abnormal tissue such as scar tissue. As a result, the ventricles cannot relax normally and expand to fill with blood, which causes the atria to become enlarged. Causes radiation, infections, hemochromatosis, amyloidosis. How amyloid causes restrictive cardiomyopathy? This is an interesting story. So, this is having a restrictive filling pattern, mutations in sarcomeric protein genes, and it is a diagnosis of exclusion. So, three forms basically, amyloidosis, then endomyocardial fibrosis, and Loffler endomyocarditis. Amyloidosis, deposition of extracellular proteins with a predilection of forming insoluble beta-pleated sheets. Cardiac amyloidosis can occur in the setting of systemic, like multiple myeloma, or restricted to the heart, like senile cardiac amyloidosis. And in senile cardiac amyloidosis, there's a mutant form of transthyretin, a liver-synthesized circulating protein that transports thyroxine in the hearts of older adult patients. And it results in restrictive cardiomyopathy. Then could be specific mutations of transthyretin that increases the risk of cardiac amyloidosis. Then endomyocardial fibrosis, principally a disease of children and young adults, is a dense, diffuse fibrosis of the ventricular endocardium and subendocardium, often involving the tricuspid and mitral valves. Loffler endomyocarditis also exhibits endocardial fibrosis associated with formation of large mural thrombi. So these are the three forms of restrictive cardiomyopathy. So there's a mutation in the sarcomeric protein, the troponin subunit, which increases the calcium sensitivity of cardiac myofilaments, increasing the contractility and producing diastolic dysfunction. So etiology I have told already, it could be mainly amyloid or fibrosis. And common presentation is congestive heart failure and patient may require transplantation. Grossly, seen restrictive cardiomyopathy, there's a biatrial dilatation due to increased filling pressure. Ventricles are normally normal size and ventricular cavity is normal. And microscopic image, there are microscopic changes are non-specific, include myocyte hypertrophy, focal or diffuse perimyocytic fibrosis, and focal myofiber disarray. You can do a Meson trichrome to demonstrate the perimyocytic fibrosis. And electron microscopy should diffuse fibrosis of the perimyocyte and characteristic lattice of collagen surrounding every myocyte. Differential diagnosis, constrictive pericarditis, obliterative endomyocardial disease, specific cardiomyopathies such as amyloidosis and hemochromatosis. Risk factors, family history of cardiomyopathy or a family history of sudden cardiac death or a history of any coronary artery disease, long-term alcoholism, long-term high blood pressure, diabetes and other metabolic diseases. This I will leave. Interventions I will not describe in detail, medications and surgery. Then I will come to the tumors. The cardiac tumors, benign, mostly it is common are the benign tumors and the malignant. And as we know, the metastasis is much more common. So the benign tumors are 75%, malignant 25%, out of which 50% are myxomas. So most common cardiac tumor is asked as a myxoma, and most common cardiac tumor in the valve, cardiac valve is the papillary fibroelastomas. And lipomas are also common. In children, the common are rhabdomyomas and fibromas. Symptoms they produce could be constitutional or systemic, embolic, cardiac, and phenomenon secondary to metastatic diseases. I will describe that, like carcinoid syndrome. And the symptoms which they produce, like in endocardium obstruction, myocardium involvement, rhythm abnormalities, and epicardium, they cause pericardial effusion or a cardiac tamponade. So, cardiac myxoma. 30 to 50% of all primary cardiac tumors arise from fossa ovalis, protrude into the atrium, may intermittently cause obstruction to left ventricular filling. It could be sporadic or familial because of the Carney syndrome association. Mean age affected is 50 years, where the pedunculated tumors may move through AV valve at systole. This wrecking ball effect may damage the valve leaflet. So I will describe the gross and microscopy of this tumor, and there is an association with the mutations in protein kinase A regulatory subunit. It is the Pericardia 1. So see the syndromic association here, the LAM, name and the Carney syndrome, which is associated with the myxomas. Carney complex, which is spotty skin pigmentation and endocrine overactivity. Grossly, how does it look like? Solitary at fossa ovalis, up to 10 cm, fragile or pedunculated, 41% have surface thrombus. Soft polyploid, rarely petrified due to repeated hemorrhage, rarely grows on both sides of fossa ovalis. Microscopic, complex structures resembling cords, nets, rings of poorly formed glands, composed of stellate or globular myxoma cells with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm, indistinct cell borders, oval nucleus with open chromatin and indistinct nuclei. Abundant mucopolysaccharide ground substance containing chondroitin sulfate and hyaluronic acid. So what is positive? The immunos can be done. CD31, 34, calvertinin, vimentin. Glandular components may be keratin positive, then factor 8 expression, and negative stains are cytokeratin and CD68. Differential diagnosis, left atrial appendage thrombus, because thrombus is much more common in the heart, metastatic carcinoma, mural myxoid thrombus, the papillary fibroelastoma. Then papillary fibroelastoma, the second tumor, is again a benign tumor. 8% of primary benign cardiac tumors found in older patients. age more than 60 years. They are small tumors, more often found on the downstream side of the vault. It's a benign papillary growth discovered incidentally, but can embolize to distal sites. So it is the most common cardiac valve tumor associated with KRAS mutations in up to 80% of the lesions. So as I told, elderly patient, what is the risk factor? Damaged endothelium, prior cardiac surgery, may arise on any endocardial line surface. Etiology is debated. Diagnosis, imaging is the most classic means. Echocardiography and CT can also help. Microscopy, multiple branching fronts of quasicellular, avascular, fibroelastic tissue lined by a single layer of endocardium looking like sea anemone, has multiple branching fronts by definition. So differential diagnoses are three. I will describe them. When positive stain, Verhoff, Van Gison and other elastic stain highlights the elastic core of the front. So KRAS mutations have been identified in up to 80% of the cases. Differential diagnosis are three, Lambert excrescence, cardiac myxomas, and valvular vegetation. So if it is asked like the DD, it can be said that it's the DD of papillary fibroelastoma. Then lipomas and pericardial lipomas, again the second most common benign cardiac tumors after myxoma. Usually it's in the left ventricle, right atrium and interatrial septum. Incidental finding rarely assumes gigantic proportions. And it can, the pericardial lipomas, they can infiltrate the myocardium. Then rhabdomyoma, 50 to 90% of primary heart tumors in children. Usually discovered in patients less than 1 year of age, may obstruct the valvular orifice. It's not a true neoplasm, but a hematoma or a malformation due to mutation in TSC1 and TSC2 genes. 50% of patients have tuberous sclerosis. Sporadic cases are occasionally associated with congenital heart disease. They though grow quite large and equal frequency in the right and left ventricular and septal myocardium. Or they can involve the both atria and nearly all are multiple. Grossly, small, firm, gray-white, well-circumscribed myocardial masses that protrude into the ventricle. They can be found as a numerous miliary nodules and called the rhabdomyomatosis. Microscopic, clear cells and large rounded polygonal cells, spider cells with glycogen vacuoles separated by strands of cytoplasm extending between cell membrane and nucleus. No mitotic activity. The adult tumors are more cellular with smaller cells, few spider cells and more cellular proliferation. The positive stain, pars positive, digestive sensitive for glycogen, myoglobin, actin, desmin, vimentin. Negative stain is S100. Many tumors regress, the rhabdomyomas, they regress. Excision if there is left ventricular outflow tract obstruction. Differential diagnosis could be a glycogen storage disease, granular cell tumor, histiocytoid myopathy, or a lipoma. Then the fibromas, they are uncommon benign tumors seen in children, rare in adults, occur in ventricular myocardium. It can have central calcifications. Presents with heart failure or cyanosis, and it is, has association with Gorlin syndrome. Microscopically, bland fibroblasts and collagen, calcification is common, more cellular in infants and children, mitotic figures in infants only. Differential diagnosis could be fibrosarcoma, fibrous histiocytoma, or a myofibroblastic tumor. So they can be confused with rhabdomyomas. So Gorlin syndrome, and then another tumor which can occur is a teratoma. It arrives within the pericardium. It does not originate from cardiac structures, generally benign, can have serious mechanical consequences by causing tamponade or through direct pressure on the heart. Treatment therefore requires either fetal tumor excision or cesarean section and immediate operation on the newborn. Then there could be cardiac hematomas or a Purkinje cell tumor. It presents in the young children and present with insufficient ventricular tachycardia. So the primary malignant tumor, we have described the benign tumors, and the malignant tumors are 15% of the primary cardiac tumors. Sarcomas are the more common. And what are sarcomas? The angiosarcomas, malignant cells that form vascular channels, may overlap with Kaposi sarcoma, which can also involve the myocardium, arise predominantly in the right atrium. So angiosarcoma, common primary malignancy of the heart, usually atrium, often in men more than 40 years. Metastasis is present at diagnosis. Grossly large infiltrating pink to dark brown lobulated mass often invades vena cava and tricuspid wall. How does it look? Obviously, it's a vascular tumor, anastomosing vascular channels forming dilated sinusoids lined by atypical cells. The prominent mitosis, hemorrhage, and necrosis. So, IHC with CD31, CD34, reticulin shows the vascular channels, and negative stains, which can be done in CK, S100, and electron microscopy demonstrates the visible pallid bodies and distorted extracellular fibrous matrix. Differential diagnosis are all the vascular tumors like hemangioendothelioma, Kaposi sarcoma, or a metastatic angiosarcoma rather than a primary cardiac angiosarcoma. Then other malignant tumors could be a rhabdomyosarcoma, which can have multiple sites of myocardial involvement, and fibrosarcomas and malignant fibrous histiocytomas, which can have white fleshy flesh appearances. With MFH, not defined as MFH and fibrosarcomas, and if we do IHCs on that, and if it is not, then it is an undifferentiated sarcoma or a pleomorphic sarcoma. Then the leiomyosarcomas, spindle cell high-grade tumors, and mesotheliomas, which can also occur in the heart. So there can be a cardiovascular effects of non-cardiac neoplasms also, like direct consequence of the tumor. Then there can be indirect consequence of tumor or effects of tumor therapy. So this has to be remembered. And there is something called as the carcinoid heart disease. Carcinoid syndrome results from bioactive compounds such as serotonin released by carcinoid tumors. It refers to the cardiac manifestation caused by the bioactive compound. So to summarize that, cardiac tumors are rare. A cardiac mass most likely represents a thrombus or a vegetation. So most primary cardiac tumors are benign. So most common benign cardiac tumor is a myxoma, and papillary fibroelastoma, it is the most common cardiac tumor of the valve. And the most common type of sarcoma or malignant tumor found is a angiosarcoma. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Cardiac tumors are very important. They are a short note in most of the exams, and especially cardiac myxoma. As a short note comes very frequently, very nicely presented. All the relevant points are there, especially the various types of cardiomyopathies, especially the rare ones, and the carcinoid tumors of the heart is another very important entity which many people, may try to forget. Thank you so much, ma'am. What is the next lecture? Are we finished with heart and blood vessels?
Yes, I have finished with heart and blood vessels.
Fine, then we will discuss subsequently exactly what we will be starting next. Fine.
Okay.
Please share the PDF, ma'am. Thank you so much. Take care, ma'am.
Yes.
Bye-bye. Take care.
Thank you.
Good night. Thank you.